Hey class, thanks for tuning in on another Mr. Huddleston Reads Crash. We are on chapter 33 right now. If you remember where we left off last time, Crash isn't having a great time right now. His grandpa is in the hospital with a stroke. Football season's over. He's pretty bummed out right now. It's Christmas time, and he just went out and he had to buy Scooter a present. He had to buy a present for his grandpa because he felt like if he didn't buy that present, it would be like he was thinking he was going to not make it. So he bought him sparkly red high heels. So we're on chapter 33, December 29th. They move him to a regular hospital room. Some doctor said he's going to be okay. The more I hear, the more it sounds like okay means not dead. My mom says he has to learn to walk again. She says he doesn't talk too good, and he doesn't remember stuff. I stop asking her what else is wrong. I don't want to know. Christmas stunk. We did all the usual things, but it was like, I don't know, pizza without pepperoni. For the first time in my life, I had to be woken up Christmas morning. As usual, my parents had Christmas CDs playing when we were downstairs. For a minute, there I thought I was at the mall. The songs are always the same singers, like a couple of prehistoric baboons named Perry Como or Bing Crosby. Perry? Bing? Do you believe the names people had in those old days? Our piles were bigger than ever. I got a Dan Marino football, and I got my own DVD player and two DVDs to add to my collection, Swamp Thing and Sports Bloopers. I got a game for my Nintendo and some Raider stuff, a jacket, wristbands, and a baseball cap, and a bunch of other stuff. It was weird. All day long, there were times when I forgot, when it all seemed regular, but it never lasted. It was like there was this grinning, twisted little demon following me around, and whenever I started to feel good, it would go, "Aha, you're forgetting," and it would whack me with a 2x4. Every year, there's the same fight. Abby and I want to take our piles up to our rooms and start using them. My parents want them to stay under the world's most boring Christmas tree until New Year's so people can come visit and see what they got us, except nobody hardly ever visits. This year, we didn't take no crap. We said, okay, you got 3 days. If nobody comes by then, the stuff goes up. And that's what happened. Well, now the only stuff under the tree is Scooter's. My mom says we'll keep everything just until he gets home. The bad part about that is that the tree is fake, so it'll last and last. Come on, Scooter. After the red shoes, I did get him a real present, a book about ships in the U.S. Navy. I'm not sure what to do about the shoes. I wrapped them up. Then I was going to throw them away, but then I thought, wait, maybe they're like a good luck charm. Who knows what bad could happen if you dump them. So, they're under my bed. Chapter 34, January 1st. Mike came over today. The rest of the family went off to visit Uncle Herm, so we had the place to ourselves. When we weren't in the kitchen, we were in my room watching the parades and bowl games and our movies and checking out each other's Christmas stuff. Mike got a new Super Soaker, and a Walkman. This is from the 90s, so some of the technology is a little bit different. Walkman is a CD player, which I didn't get. He got a TV, but my old one was bigger, 21 inches to 18 inches for him. Plus, he didn't have the auto sleep off or the wake up on his remote like I do. He got three tapes to my two, but my two cost more than his three. I whipped out my Raiders jacket. Check this, baby. I put it on along with the Raiders wristbands and the cap. He flipped his hand. Ah, that ain't nothing. That's a rag. My Dallas Cowboys jacket I got last year is still better than that thing. He was sneering, but he couldn't take his eyes off of my jacket if I wanted to. He would have traded his Cowboys for my Raiders and given me free use of his squirt gun for weeks besides. But when his sneer turned to a smirk, an evil grin, I knew what was coming. He hadn't said anything about his sneakers the whole time, and neither did I. I pretended I didn't notice them. But he had been waiting, saving them for last. He was sitting on my desk chair. He put both feet up on my desk. "Okay," he said, grinning. "Check these." They were the most beautiful shoes I had ever seen. Every time I went to the mall lately, I would stop at Foot Locker and stare at them. I put them on my Christmas list, but my father said no way he was going to spend more on a pair of shoes than 1 week's worth of groceries. Besides, he said, the pair I have are perfectly good. On the last night, I talked to Scooter before the morning and the cherry tree. I asked him to try and change my father's mind. He said he would try, but I guess he never got the chance. About the last thing I remember him saying was, "Don't worry so much about it. It's not the sneakers that count. It's the feet." I sneered at Mike. "I've seen better." He grinned. He held them bottoms out to me. "Check the soles, baby." They were gorgeous. I felt woozy. 3 colors. I could see myself jumping over backboards, defenders, and them sobbing like babies, spectators grasping at moves no human had ever seen before. He stuck one out in front of my face. I could smell the white skin, smooth leather. I smacked the foot away. "It ain't the sneakers," I said. "It's the feet." He looked at me like I was crazy. Then he laughed. He knew I didn't believe it. While we were watching one of the movies Mike had brought over, he got hungry again and went down to the kitchen. When he came back, he had a jelly donut in his hand and a sailor hat on his head, and he had the sides pulled down like a white bowl, like Gilligan. "Where'd you get it?" I said. "The kitchen." "The hat. The room down the hall. What are you doing in there?" His tongue drilled into the donut and came out with a clump of jelly, and he shrugged. "Looking around. Ain't that old dude's room, your grandfather?" "Take it off," I said. Scooter never wears the hat. It sits on his bedpost. He said me and Abby could wear it if we ever wanted to. Mike wasn't moving except for his tongue, drilling for jelly. I jumped up and I ripped the hat from his head. "Hey," he squawked, "what are you doing? I thought you said he was in the hospital. He don't need it. He's old." I screamed, "He's not old." And I charged down the hall and I folded the brim back up like it was supposed to be. I stuck it back on the bedpost. My hands were shaking. My throat felt funny. My eyes, too. I went into the bathroom and shut the door and sat on the edge of the tub. The doorbell rang. I went downstairs. I could hear that in my room, Mike had switched to sports bloopers. I did what I usually do when someone comes over, and I peeked from the edge of the bay windows. It was Webb. He kept pushing the bell button and staring at the door like a dope. He had a package in his hand, sort of square, wrapped in brown paper and string. It took him forever to give up. I could see him open the door, storm door, and stoop. When he walked away, he didn't have the package anymore. I gave him a minute to get down the street and then open the door. I brought the package inside. I could see how that the paper was cut from a supermarket bag. An envelope was taped to the top. Inside was a note. The klutzy handwriting was Webb's. "Dear Mr. Scooter, my parents and I are very sorry to hear about your illness. We hope you get well very soon. In order to help you, I'm sending you this jar of mud from the Missouri River. It was given to me by my great-grandfather Henry Wilhide Webb III, who dived to the bottom of the river to get it 71 years ago. There is a legend about Missouri River mud where we used to live. I have told your grandson, John, and I'm sure he will be pleased to tell it to you. Your friend, Penn W. Webb. P.S. As you can see, the mud is dry. Just add water." Upstairs, Mike was howling at the sports bloopers. I stuck the note back in the envelope, and I stood in the window looking out. I don't know how much later, something hit me on the head. It was Mike bonking me with my new football. "Man, that's the funniest thing I ever saw. Can I take it home for a couple days?" "Go ahead," I said. I turned back to the window. "Who was at the door?" "Nobody." "What's that?" "What, in your hand?" "Nothing." "Well," he said, "time to eat. You got any frozen pizzas?" "Yeah." "So let's make one." "Go ahead," I said. "I ain't hungry." I will pause there for now. Pretty deep chapter. You can tell there's a lot kind of going on with Crash during this, and sounds like he's kind of tired of his friend Mike DeLuca's attitude and messing with his grandfather's hat and stuff like that. And kind of think about what it took for Penn Webb to give that special Missouri mud to Scooter and for Crash, and how much Penn still cares about this guy and his grandfather, even though Crash has been so mean to him, he still cares. And I think that act really changed something about Crash, and you can kind of see him, you know, as we listen, it kind of seems like he's processing something and trying to figure that out as he was staring out the window. So I think this was a big moment in Crash's life. So we'll see what happens next. Stay tuned, guys. Till next time.